Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your uttermost favorite brother from another mother. Hope you guys are all doing all right. I'm just here worshiping the Lord, you know, singing, "Oh, how I love Jesus." Amen. Oh, how I love Jesus. Do you love Jesus? Well, if you do, you ought to be happy about it. Oh, how I love Jesus. Why? Because he first loved me. He first loved me. He first loved you. Hallelujah. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Hallelujah, the Bible tells us. Praise his holy, blessed name forever and ever and ever and ever and ever, brothers and sisters. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God through whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all ye creatures here below. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You know, brothers and sisters, I don't always listen to hymnal music, but I listen to anointed music, and this is very anointed. That's why I play it a lot of times on videos. A lot of the modern worship music that I might listen to, it's got like a more of a, this is a cappella. Lots of the music has music, lots of the praise and worship music has instrumental music on there too. It can be loud, and you know, a lot of times in churches, we have to be, you know, because I've been preaching in, you know, in churches with people, you know, singing and praying and praising the Lord behind you, like a choir or people singing. And, you know, it's a matter of having that volume right for the way the Lord's moving. You know, sometimes we're praising the Lord and jumping around and, you know, praising the Lord, then you need it loud. And then there's times when, you know, like an altar call where you want to be, it's more of a quietness, you know. And it's not a matter of boisterousness, but being still and waiting on the Lord. So I noticed that this a cappella music and hymnal songs is much more compelling to also be able to think and stuff, you know. So praise God, brothers and sisters. Praise God. Anyway, I want to tell you about the... I just want to get on here and tell you guys about the conference we had. I'll get a copy of it. They're going to edit it or whatever, process it. They got like they had like professional cameras and all that there at the church. And they're going to get a copy. I guess they're going to send a copy first to Sister Linda Kirby. And then she, you know, who she did her What's Happening Now news there. Talked about the rapture, pre-tribulation rapture versus the people that don't believe in the pre-tribulation rapture. She talked about several points on that topic. And they had a dinner and all this, and then I was able to bring a revival message that, you know, one of the revival messages that the Lord has given me for the church. So praise God for that, brothers and sisters. I live with the opportunity to minister. And by the grace of God, I was able to also sow 100 books into that community as we were at a Methodist church, you know, and there was an elderly lady in the church who talked to me afterwards, and she told me that she hasn't, you know, there's nobody's preached in that church. She hasn't heard any preaching like what I preached since she was a young woman, many, many years, she said. So praise God, you know, that the Lord sent me to bring back, you know, the gospel message to one of our dead and dying denominations here in the world and in the U.S., one of the Laodicean churches, lukewarm churches. So praise God for that. And I asked you guys to pray that those 100 books that I gave away there, yes, if you'd have come, I would have given away books. I told people to take all they wanted. And if I just told people they felt like making a donation, they could or not. It doesn't matter. I gave away, like I said, 100 books. So praise God, brothers and sisters. They took them all. And, you know, what impact they'll have in that community. It's a pretty good-sized church. I guess they probably have, I'd say, maybe 1,000 members. I don't know, 500 to 1,000. It's a good-sized church. They even call it a campus. You know, it's a big church when they call it a campus. Instead of a church, you got a whole campus there. And so praise God, those 100 books will filter through that area there. And some people who watched me on YouTube came, visitors even drove 2 or 3 hours away. I won't name their names on here. Some brothers and sisters, and I praise God for that. And they got some books too to take back where they're from, 2 or 3 hours away in different places, North Carolina and South Carolina. So praise God for that. And I believe it'll be a blessing. And I was able to sow 20 vials of oil, and lots of the Methodists took the oil too. So praise God, you know, prayer oil. And so, you know, by the grace of God, you know, they'll be moving more in a spirit-filled life, from a religious life you know, to a born-again committed life and then the spirit-filled born-again Christian life. And that's what we want to do, brothers and sisters. That's the message that's been in my heart since I started in the ministry. You know, the first message that I ever preached in the church, I was teaching Sunday school for about 2 or 3 months. As a matter of fact, I started at the beginning of January 2001, and the first sermon I preached was the last Sunday of February 2001, so it was 2 months. The first sermon I preached, I made an outline, and I've still got it in my parents' family Bible. There I have a sermon, and it was Duties of a Christian in the Last Days. That was in February 2001. So from the very beginning, brothers and sisters, it's been announcing the return of the Lord to judge the quick and the dead, and then how to get ready for that. Be prepared to meet the Lord in the air. How to be one of the five wise virgins. To be worthy, as Jesus said, Luke 21:36, watch ye and pray ye always that you be kind of worthy to escape these things. What things? The tribulation. And stand before the Son of Man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because you have patiently kept my word, or kept the word of my patience, I will keep you out of the hour of trial that will come upon the whole earth to try. Hour of temptation, come on the earth to try all those who live upon the earth. Revelation 3:10. Brothers and sisters, that's the message. It's the message I've been doing since I started on YouTube. The message I give is always the same. You know, when I make videos about dreams and visions, I think I mentioned this in a video the other day, there's always people that, you know, that'll say, oh, Brother Patrick, why are you're not just telling about your dream, or just telling about the vision that you had? Why are you giving an interpretation of it? And why are you preaching? And so we just want to hear your message. We just want to hear the dream or vision. We don't want to hear you preaching. See, that's the very people that the dream or vision would do them no good. God doesn't give us dreams or visions to entertain us, but to grow us, to develop us. They're a call to action, a call to response, a call to preparation. That's why dreams and visions and words from the Lord need to be interpreted. They need to be translated from God's elders, as it says in the Bible, right there in 1 Corinthians. It says that in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and chapter 14, talk about the gifts of the Spirit. It says that if someone prophesies, then the elders are supposed to determine whether that word be from the Lord or not. That's why it says don't let more than 2 or 3 prophesy at a time, you know, in a given service. So that way the elders can judge whether that word be from God or not. Now an elder in the modern day church is almost always preachers, even though you don't have to be a preacher to be an elder. All preachers are elders, but not elders are all elders are preachers, brothers and sisters. Some churches have elders, which is, to me, very proper. When you go to, like, I originally came out of a Baptist church, they have deacons, and the deacons are trying to act as elders. Deacons are not elders. Deacons are supposed to administer the natural carnal flesh administration of the church, like mowing the grass at the church, making sure if they're going to have some food that they're going to cook it, go, you know, and visit some church people, assist the pastor in all ways that he wants to, and do the natural thing, you know, move the furniture around the church, carry the pastor here to there, whatever needs to be done, help, you know, a widow in the church move from one house to the next or whatever. Not the spiritual things. Read Acts chapter 6. You will see that the deacons were given the authority over the natural things. A lot of churches, they've got carnal-minded people appointed into those carnal offices of deacons, the carnal administrative work of the church, maybe even counting the money or whatever they do, you know, and all these things, the budget for the building and whatnot, and shall we add on to the building or not, whatever. They try to operate in the spiritual authority of the elders of the church, and deacons are not elders. Elders operate in what's going on spiritually in the church. That's why in that Acts chapter 6, we see the apostles saying, look, we're going to give all of our time and energy to teaching the word of God and discipling the people and hearing from God and praying and fasting and all that. We need people who's going to handle the daily earthly administration. I say carnal, but it's another word for saying the earthly administration of the church. Now, as I said, so elders, brothers and sisters, are people who are in spiritual authority in the church, not deacons. The spiritual authority of the church are elders. And that's why it says that all elders are worth, you know, you're supposed to give, the church is supposed to support the elders and then double honor to elders who also teach. So if you're an elder in the church, you're supposed to be supported by the church. And then if you're a teach or preach, you're supposed to get a double honor, double portion honorarium, as they say, or a gift from the church whenever you would also preach. That's what the Bible says many times. But anyway, that's not my point. My point was just to give you an example where we're talking about elders versus deacons. So anyway, brothers and sisters, the church administration is not all of this Nicolaitan. As it says in Revelation, two different churches, Jesus talks about the Nicolaitans, and he says he hates the deeds of the Nicolaitans. Now, Nicolaitan is a word that means like the word laity. You've heard that before. The regular church members, Nicolaitan is victory over the laity. You know, someone asked me the other day if that's what I believed it meant. Yes, I've made videos about it way back two or three years ago. That a great example, the ultimate example in the Christendom. Notice I didn't say Christianity or the church. Christendom includes all things associated with Christianity. Even Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses, and all that. So Christendom is not, everybody in Christendom is not a Christian. But all Christians are in Christendom. Just like not all elders are preachers, but all preachers are elders. If you can get that. So all the true church is part of Christendom, but Christianity is just the true church. Christendom includes those other groups, as I said, and people in churches that are not saved, and denominations that are not teaching properly, that are cults, etc., whatever they may be. So in Roman Catholicism is the ultimate example, I was going to say, within Christendom of this victory over the laity, with this priestly class and all that, where in the New Testament we don't have priests. It says we're all kings and priests unto the Lord. So there are no priests in the New Testament. Ephesians 4:11 tells us the offices in the church. The priest was like the Levites, and then the Levitical priesthood. And then, you know, there's the sons of Aaron, which is the Kohenites, and the different branches of the different clans within the tribe of Levi had their different tasks related to the temple and ministering to the people, all descendants of Levi. And then there's the Melchizedek priesthood that Jesus is after order of Melchizedek forever. A new priesthood for the New Testament. That's the order of Melchizedek. We see that in Hebrews, and then back there in Genesis when the king of Salem, met with Abraham and they had bread and wine. And that's Melchizedek himself, which was, you know, an example of the pre-incarnated Christ, a theophany or a Christophany. You know, I said that in one of my videos before, and I had some, you know, you can tell people, well, you're talking about a Christophany. What is that? Well, it's a very, very common term among high theologians. And all of theologians know that stuff. You know, that's a common term. The Lord Jesus Christ appearing in the Old Testament. He appeared to Joshua at the Battle of Jericho. He appeared to Abraham with the two angels and talked to Abraham when the two angels were getting ready to go into Sodom, when he told Abraham at about this time next year, you're going to have a son. That was Isaac. And so I was just giving those examples. But and Melchizedek, I believe Melchizedek was a pre-incarnated Christ also. And that's why in Hebrews it says that he had no beginning and no end, no mother, no father. And that's why Jesus is after the order of Melchizedek. So some people, you know, as a matter of fact, when I got ordained, the people that ordained me, they each asked me different questions on the day that I was ordained. And one of them, that's the Reverend Arthur P. Kane Jr. is his name. One of the people who ordained me, and he asked me, who do I think Melchizedek was? And so I told him I thought Melchizedek was the Lord Jesus Christ pre-incarnated, and he said he thought that Melchizedek was actually, you know, the Father appearing, you know, the angel of the Lord. So that's, you know, this is the debates they have in theology, you know, the angel of the Lord. Who is that? Is that the angel of the Father? Is it the Lord Jesus Christ? And so these are debates that high theologians have and discuss, you know, in theology that are, so it's funny and hilarious to me when someone who just got saved a year ago, who's on the internet correcting pastors and telling people, and, you know, and these are things that theologians can't agree on 100%, but we know it's either the Father or the Son. And, so, you know, people are just dogmatic about something. They don't even know what they're talking about. That's why it's, you know, God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. And there's lots of dogmatic arrogance of new believers. And that's why I always ask them, do you do the same thing to your doctor? Do you go to your doctor's office and correct him because you saw a video on YouTube on brain surgery or something? You know, there used to be a TV show called Surgery or something, or The Surgeon. And my brother, he had a uncle-in-law, the uncle of his wife. There's a million stories about this guy. His first name is Randy. He's still alive, as a matter of fact. I need to start telling the stories about Randy. I hear all these stories, and it's like, it's so unbelievable. I told my brother he could write a book about it. As a matter of fact, it does sound unbelievable. If I didn't know the guy, because my brother married a girl and she had a sister who I dated before when I was in high school, before my brother's, like a year or two later, he started dating his wife and then they got married. But I dated her sister a couple years before. And so I already knew this guy even before. I've known this guy since I was, you know, like 15, 16 years old. And it's the guy's really, but anyway, what was I? I don't even remember what I was going to tell you about old Randy. I can't even remember. Oh yeah, he when they came out with that show Surgery, he would watch it, and then he really said he was going to do surgery on people. I mean, this guy's like the Jethro Bodine, you know. He can do Cyphering and Gazintas and all that stuff. Those of you know what I'm talking about. All kinds of insanity. And I would love to tell stories about him. As a matter of fact, one time he was deaf. He said he was deaf. He was trying to get disability. And he is on disability now. And he's in a wheelchair and all this. But then people have seen him walking. But one time he said he was deaf. And then somebody called him on the phone. And I don't know how he was on the phone. I think he said he could hear a little bit in one ear. But anyway, while he was on the phone, he said that lightning struck the phone, ran through the phone, and then he could hear again. And I mean, just, there's a thousand stories about this guy. Every time I see my brother, I hear some stories about it. It's just like, I told him we're gonna write a book, you know. I'm gonna get permission to write the story. It's crazy. But anyhow, I don't even know where I was talking about now, brothers and sisters. Praise God, praise God. So I guess I would have to stop my video back and listen to it, pick back up where I was at. Well, you know how I am, brothers and sisters. I just wanted to come on here and you just worship the Lord and talk about the Lord wherever the Lord would lead me. Worship Him. I had a message going on in there somewhere. Praise God Almighty, brothers and sisters. God is awesome. You know, and I appreciate those of you who watch me. And because it is true that I don't follow a expository, you know, verse-by-verse teaching too much. I do sometimes. And I go all around where the Lord would lead me by His Spirit. And, you know, the other people on the YouTube who are supposed to be preachers, but they're just giving the news. And it's, you know, for me, I like to get my news directly from the source and search it out. Even, you know, even lots of news websites, when you look, you'll go look for the source and you'll see that the headline's not necessarily matching what the story says. They'll grab one headline and that's like the fact they want to push. And then when you read the article, it doesn't say all that. So it takes time to research those things out and see what's really going on. Try to figure out what's really going on. There's so much disinformation. So, but brothers and sisters, I just want to say we've got to be steadfast and immovable in the Lord and not be tossed to and fro, you know, by every wind of doctrine and by every news story that comes up every day and just, you know, roller coastering ourselves. I've been waiting for the day when people would tire. And I, you know, and then if they fall away, you know, I can't help it. If people are going to fall away because the rapture hasn't happened yet, well, you know, it's those, one of those questions is, were they really saved or what's going on? You know, the Lord knows all these things. But I just want to say this, that I've been waiting for the day since I've been on YouTube. I've been waiting for the day when people are going to stop running to and fro. I've been waiting for people to stop looking at the popularity contest and people that are the most entertaining and the most cute who are not preaching the gospel but are giving exaggerated news stories. And getting people, I mean, how many days can you drink 5 pots of coffee and shake like a chihuahua and worry that the world is coming to an end when the Bible says, as an example, that it's a world without end. Amen. Like 4 or 5 times throughout the Bible says it's a world without end. Amen. God's not going to destroy the earth. He's going to renew the earth. It says when it's burned up with fire there in Peter, in the Greek, it said God will renew the earth, remodel it, renew it, restore it like it was in the Garden of Eden. Just like when we get saved, we're still the same person, but our spirit is renewed. And then when we get our raptured body, it's still us. You're still going to be you when you get raptured. So when we say we get a new body, the truth is we're getting a renewed body. And so it's still us, brothers and sisters, but renewed in a different form. In other words, now we're made out of dirt, incorruptible, but we'll have incorruptible. So when the earth is restored, now it's made out of dirt, etc., but it will be made out of some other material that it won't be, you know, that's incorruptible. Just like we will be in a new material that's incorruptible, but it looks about the same. A different molecules and atoms and elements or whatever that we don't know about. Some kind of inert elements instead of out of decaying elements that we're made out of now. The earth will be, and us, the whole creation will be renewed. in a form that is incorruptible, brothers and sisters, that fadeth not away. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. So I know I'm preaching to the choir, but I pray for the day when you know what it used to be. As Paul said in 1st or 2nd Timothy, he says that, you know, in the last days, I think it's 2nd Timothy chapter 3 or 1st Timothy chapter 3, I can't remember, says that, you know, in the end times, people cannot endure sound doctrine. You know, that they're heaping to themselves people that's tickling their ears, and then there people are, you know, people are immature in the faith, very immature. They don't want to be discipled. Now, that's the downside of YouTube. There's lots of people on YouTube. That's what I was starting to say about the Nicolaitans and all that. That's what the message that the Lord was leading me to say. It's coming back to me. See, the Lord led me in from another angle. See, I'm back to where I was at when I was talking about the Nicolaitans. How about that? See, even though my mind is loopy, but the Lord has got a message here and there somewhere by His Spirit. Oh, I was talking about the Catholics being an extreme example in Christendom of victory over the laity, this thing. And then there are people on YouTube, the majority of people, lots of people on YouTube, a majority, maybe it's a majority of Christians on YouTube, are the opposite of that. It's like anarchy. You know, the inverted version of Catholicism, where Catholicism, you have this thing, it says, you know, Peter holds the keys to the gates of heaven, and the Pope is in the stead of Peter, so they claim, it's not true, and so they hold the keys to who can enter heaven and who does not. So if you don't die in a state of grace, you can't. This is what Catholicism teaches. If you don't die in a state of grace, you cannot enter heaven. You have to go to purgatory or you would go to hell, depending. So the only way to die in a state of grace is to be in good standing with the church, because you have to receive the sacraments of the church. If you do not receive the sacraments of the church, you have not have any grace infused into you, and then you don't die in a state of grace. That's why a lot of Catholics, I know Catholics who call the communion, well, we call the communion, they call it the Eucharist. They call it vitamin J, vitamin Jesus. You know, they take that and they're getting infused with grace. So when they die, they want to get the last rites, or the real name is extreme unction. They want to receive the extreme unction. Therefore, the priest is basically opening the gate and say, okay, you go into heaven as a representative of the Pope. Who claims to be the vicar of Christ, as the Pope is claiming to be the representative of Christ in Peter's chair, so they claim, then the priest has that authority. So this church, the Catholic Church, is definitely 100% of what the Lord was prophesying about the Nicolaitans. They're claiming they have authority and victory over the laity that God did not give to any man. Jesus is our only judge, not any priest or preacher or anybody. Like these cult groups, David Koresh or whatever, they're claiming they're the Messiah. They claim they have this authority to send people to hell or heaven and all that. That's the cult. That's the devil. Only the Lord can send you to heaven or hell. Preacher's job is to proclaim to you the word of God and what's God's standard. This is what God says. If you're born again, no one can enter. Jesus said, John 3:3, no man can enter the kingdom of heaven except they be born again. Jesus said that. So that's what I tell you. I proclaim that. I'm just a messenger. You know, and then I'll tell you, well, you know, according to the word of God, you're living in sin. You know, if you ask me or if the Lord leads me, I'll tell you, hey, you know, you're living in sin. You claim, you're denying that Jesus is the Christ. You're denying that he can forgive your sins. You're denying that you're a sinner. You know, based on the word of God, hey, you can't enter the kingdom of heaven. You know, it's not my judgment. Out of your own mouth, the Bible, Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So what's in your heart's coming out of your mouth. I can tell you that. Okay, you know, but we can't say, oh, you are going to hell. I say you're going to hell. No, it's judging people. Or I can say, oh, you're going to heaven. See, it's also judging people. You are going to heaven. We don't have the authority to tell people they're going to heaven or hell. We can give them the word. And as I always say, and I said at the church the other night, Romans 8:16, His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. It's between us and God, between our spirit and the Holy Spirit, that we know whether we're saved or not. We got to know in our heart from the Lord that we're saved or not. That's where it comes from. In line, in accordance with His word. Anyway, so on YouTube, we have the opposite. We have the opposite. We have this anarchy. I have people that'll message me calling me by my first name, which I don't mind people calling me by my name without calling me pastor, but it just shows, especially the belligerent messages they send me, it shows me they have no respect for God's elders in the church, for the authority that God gives to all pastors, all elders in the church. So when they call me Matthew, usually that tells me they didn't watch my videos, because All you guys who watch my videos know I never go by Matthew. I go by my middle name, Patrick. So if they'd even watched one of my videos and listened, and either they didn't watch my videos or they're not listening. They're hearing, but they're not listening. I go by Patrick. And then I don't mind, like I said, I don't mind anybody calling me Patrick or Brother Patrick. But when someone just says, "Hey, Patrick, don't you know there's no rapture?" Or, "Hey, Patrick, don't you know that the church has to keep the law? We all have to keep the law, or you're going to hell?" And all this belligerent comments they make and calling me Matthew. I know that, number one, they didn't listen to my videos. B, they're not paying attention. C, they're not giving me the respect and authority that God gave me in the church. And D, they have no idea what they're talking about from what they said. So there's lots of people on YouTube, a.k.a. trolls, who do not respect God's authority in his elders that he placed in the church. And, you know, you have to answer to God for that. Not just me, anybody that is called by God, that is, a minister of the gospel. And someone's calling, like Paul said, you know, when he went to see the apostles, you know, who they claimed to be somebody. You know, he said they claimed to be somebody. You know, I don't know that they're somebody or not. He even called them one time and talked about the super apostles. And what Paul said is, my apostleship is you. He told the church, you know, you are the fruit. You know, you are the evidence of my apostleship. So anybody, as Jesus said, and Jesus was talking about preachers. When, you know, a lot of times we love to keep quoting the text where it says, you know, judge them by the fruit they bear, where Jesus is talking in Matthew chapter 7. He was particularly and specifically talking about false prophets and preachers, us, pastors. And he said, you can judge them by the fruit they bear. So that's what Paul went on to say. Look, I've led all these thousands of people to the Lord. I planted churches all over the Greek Empire or the Roman Empire. And this is the evidence that I am an apostle. I went where no man has went. And was the first one to, you know, to plant these churches and win people to the Lord and did the work of an apostle. This is the evidence of my apostleship. So anybody that claims to be a preacher, that's what Jesus told you to do. Look at the fruit they bear. Myself or anybody else. You look at the ministry and the people saved, churches planted, you know, people healed, etc. You know, signs and wonders following the ministry, all those things. We go look and see. Then we say, hey, this person is truly called by God and is confirmed by the signs and wonders following. It's confirmed by the fruit of the ministry. You know, people are getting saved. People are being baptized. People are growing in the Lord. People got healed, etc., etc. Planted orphanages, whatever. All those things, brothers and sisters. This is the stamp of approval and sign of the calling of God in someone's life. So anyway, that's what I say. The problem on YouTube is the anarchy. And the total lack of structure. And that's why you have so many people, brothers and sisters, making videos. And Brother Gary and I were talking about that earlier today. There's some people on YouTube, been on there for years. They've got thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of subscribers. They make prophecies all the time, and none of it ever comes to pass. And then they're just babbling. When people ask them, well, I'm just saying what God said to say. They don't even know what scripture supported or anything. They're not called by God. They're untrained, undiscipled, undisciplined, tons of them. People running to and fro. As a matter of fact, even tonight I had somebody message me and saying that, because I made a video way back saying that I had a dream, and it could be only a dream, of the Antichrist, and the guy was a white guy with blue eyes. And somebody messaged on there and said, well, it's already been revealed that Obama's the Antichrist. And I've had tons of people tell me this. But this guy just said to me tonight on one of my old videos, it's been confirmed that Obama's the Antichrist, and it's written in Book 12 of some prophecy group. Now, all these people are a bunch of these charismatics, spooky spiritual people. Now, what I mean by charismatics, I'm talking about people that are spirit-filled, but they go to old denominations. And those people, Assemblies of God, as an example, was started to get people to be, well, by one Baptist and one Methodist preacher. And the purpose of that denomination was to keep Pentecostal people rooted and grounded in the Word. In other words, they wanted to bring the Baptist fanatical desire to be Bereans, which is the number one and best aspect of the Baptist church, and why God uses the Baptist church for evangelism all the time, is because they're fanatically rooted and grounded in the Word and want to be Bereans, but they don't have the Spirit to go by the Spirit of the Word. They go by the letter of the Word, but not the Spirit. And Assemblies of God, what they try to do is bring that Pentecostalism in line with being a Berean. And that's, brothers and sisters, that's what, where I come in on YouTube, and that's where God sent me. To, from a Baptist background, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to bring that rooted and grounded in the Word, Berean mind with a Spirit-filled heart, and bring those two together. And that's where you're going to find, you're going to find the middle of the road of following Christianity without getting spooky spiritual, like these, most of the charismatics, just every wacky thing, any wacky thing that people say that they don't even open the Bible, don't even know the Bible, just every little wacky doctrine they hear that's totally opposite of the Bible, they just throw it out there. Because if you read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, it clearly says the Antichrist will not be revealed until the restrainer is removed. If you read the whole chapter, some people like to read this the first few verses, or they don't even read it. They saw it, they copied and pasted off what somebody else said. If you read the entire chapter, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, you will see that when the restrainer is removed, the Antichrist will come forward and come to power. And that Antichrist will be revealed when he makes a seven-year covenant with many to divide the land of Israel, rebuild the temple, and all those things, Daniel 9, 26 and 27. Now that's when he'll be revealed. They have not made a seven-year covenant. These same wacky people say that when Obama got inaugurated as the President of the United States, like every president has done, that was a covenant with many. The covenant in that is, as I said, is to divide the land. It's got nothing to do with getting inaugurated president. Plus, Obama's already been president for 7 years. None of the tribulation has happened. I'm waiting for all those people that are following these false, and one of them is really, really creepy, a freaky, creepy dude. I even have a atheist relative who I thought maybe he could get into this creepy weirdo stuff, even though he was on and on about Obama being the Antichrist. I thought it would be a bridge to this atheist relative of mine to Christianity, and he started watching me. He's like, that guy is so spooky and creepy, I can't watch him. And he is. I'm waiting for all those false prophets. When Obama's out of his time in office, and then he goes back to live in Asheville, North Carolina, and be drop off the map like all former presidents do, generally speaking. I'm waiting for all those people that run to and fro with all these false prophecies. I'm waiting for them to come sit down and shut up and be discipled by true ministers. And I am just one of them. There are many true preachers, but there are very, I don't know, there are hardly any, maybe just, I can count on one hand those that are on YouTube that are true elders in the church who are on YouTube. I know there's this, what's his name? Pastor Fott. I can't even say his name. He's in Hawaii. As an example, I can't, is it Fott? I don't want to say Fott Dog or something or whatever. I can't, I don't know. In Hawaii. And a few others. So I'm waiting for that day, brothers and sisters. I'm waiting for that day for people to just chill out and get discipled by true preachers. Now, we don't have to go, and I'll just say it again, I've been saying it since I've been on YouTube, there is absolutely nothing wrong with people making videos of the dreams they had and visions on it. Nothing wrong with none of that. I'm not knocking any of those things. But when people who are not preachers start giving doctrine, that's what I'm talking about, people giving doctrine. It's not for people to give doctrine. If you had a dream, you tell your dream, you say what you think it means, etc. Not all this date setting and all this other nonsense. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I don't know why I keep rambling on about it. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. I appreciate all of you guys, and I know I'm preaching to the choir. But there'll be some special people on here, you know. Some special friends from the land of Oz or wherever they're from another dimension who might grace this video with their exalted presence. And it's always, like I say, brothers and sisters, it's always the same. On a regular basis, probably once a week, I get someone to message me and says they got saved last week and they're going to be the next Moses. And I need to listen to them. We all need to listen to them. And sometimes they say, oh, yeah, you need to give me the money. God said you're supposed to pay my way to Israel because I'm going to go win all of Israel to Christ. And God said that you're going to give me the money to go and you're supposed to make a video promoting me and raising money for me to go to Israel because I am the reincarnated Moses. And I've heard, you wouldn't believe it, brothers and sisters, and I try not to be like, you know, making, you know, I try not to go calling people's names and making negative videos. I just, talking about tonight, I usually, if you guys who watch me, my regular views, you know, I don't usually get into it too much. But sometimes I say, oh, you know, I ought to make a video about this person, call their name out, and their YouTube name out, and, you know, hoping that maybe embarrass them into seeing how silly they are. that they've actually, as they used to say, they've jumped time. They actually have jumped time. You know, cars, you used to have to set the timing on cars before. And my dad used to do some mechanical work on the side. And, you know, my dad used to drive a race car, too, on the side. How about that for a redneck? He was a truck driver, and he drove a race car for 3 or 4 years. And so I used to help him when I was a kid, just whatever I could. And he had people, though, too, mechanics and stuff and all that. But anyway, you have this. I used to help him. You hold this timing light to the engine, and then every time that spins around, you just keep turning the distributor cap until this lines line up on the engine or whatever with the timing of that light. And so the old expression that they used to say, probably a lot of people don't know, or younger people from other parts of the country, if someone has jumped time, it means they got a screw loose. You know, they're a few bricks shy of a full load. You know, they've got one wheel, you know, they got at least one wheel in the dirt. You know, they're off track there a little bit. They've gone off the rails on the crazy train. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I hope you guys are all having a great, blessed day in the Lord. And I'm going to get this video loaded. And as soon as I get that, I've still got to work on my slideshow of the feeding programs and the orphans and get that loaded. And then I will load the conference when I get it. And I guess I'll put, it's going to be in one piece. Sister Linda Kirby's going to be on there, and then some singing with his brother, and then me. And so if you don't want to watch any of those guys, you can skip to me, or if you just want to watch them and not watch me, it'll all be one piece. And you can watch it on my channel or Sister Linda's channel. And I hope we'll have it up this week. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all so much. I hope you guys all have a blessed day in the Lord, or blessed night, whatever you watch this tomorrow. And, you know, of course, it's Columbus Day, and some cities are celebrating Indigenous Peoples Day. And however you want to look at it, Christianity was brought to the world, and Israel's been protected up until this year as a result of Christopher Columbus coming to America, you know, to the New World. It ended up to a catalyst, you know, to the greatest revival and move of Christianity in the history of the church through America, and also protecting Israel, as I said, and led to the birth of Israel, really, as America, you know, was a key player in winning World War II. You know, and in securing the peace for Israel to go back and be a nation and all that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless. Have a blessed night, day, whatever time you watch this. God bless.